to the channel. I hope you're all doing well. I hope you're all excited for the new Sylvaneth release. You've only got a couple of days and then you'll be able to get your battle tome and your new scenery and your new ender spells in your hobby hands. Anyway, before we can do that, I'm going to go over the endless spells, so because we've got pictures of the war scrolls. I'm going to give you my opinion. Also got the scenery as well. So I hope you will bear with me as we go down the rabbit hole that is AOS war scrolls. And if you enjoy the video, please leave a like. If you're not a subscriber, please subscribe. And if you are already a subscriber, please share this, because being a small channel, we do get lost in the, you know, in the vast amount of searches for other channels. So if you could share the video, it would mean so much. Anyway, that was enough shilling. Let's just get on with the show. Right then, guys, first up we've got the Spite Swarm Hive. It's the mound of the bee's nest basically on the ground with everything coming out. So Spite Swarm is a single model. Only Sylvaneth wizards can attempt to cast some of Spite Swarm Hive. It has a casting value of 7. If successful, set up the Spite Swarm Hive wholly within 15 inches of the caster. So I'm guessing thematically it just erupts from the ground because you were calling it forth. So it's nice. It's, you know, you've got an average roll, so you've got a 50-50 chance of summoning it. And yeah, it's good distance. You could set it up 15 inches forward or 15 inches back depending on where the battle is. So the hive nourishes. At the end of the hero phase, if this model is on the battlefield, the player who set it up can pick one of the effects below and immediately resolve the effect. The same unit cannot be picked and to be affected by this ability more than once per hero phase. So we've got Vital Venoms, which is roll a dice for each Sylvaneth unit wholly within 8 inches of this model. On a 2+, add 3 inches to the unit's normal moves and charge moves until the end of that turn. Or Shielding Swarm, roll a dice for each Sylvaneth unit wholly within 8 inches of this model. On a 2+, reroll save rolls of 1 for the attack that target this unit until the end of the turn. So you've got either a boost in your movement or you've got a boost in your saves, which if you want to produce a cloud of flies, which is basically, you know, what's happening, it's always going to have your save rolls, especially if you're going into, like, you know, the heat of battle and it's battle line versus battle line. I think this is probably going to be the weaker out of 3, but it's still a really good spell. So I got a feeling at the moment that Sylvaneth are a very heavy magic phase army, and it's going to be a lot of choices for your magic. So it just depends on how you want to equip them, and it doesn't seem to be a bad choice. There's better choices, but this is going to be one of those armies where they don't really have a bad choice, just different flavors of good. So yeah, I'm really not looking forward to seeing Sylvaneth on the table, but that's only the first war scroll. Let's have a look at the rest. Next up, ladies and gents, we've got the Vengeful Skullroot, which, if you've got a picture to hand, is the floating ghost tree, which I think is a very cool looking model. I do think it's, you know, it's got that ruler cool. I probably would use it if I had a Sylvaneth army, but unfortunately, corn all the way here. So before I tangent again, Vigil skill root is single model. Eventual skill root is a predatory and a spell that can move up to 8 inches and fly. To summon it, it is a casting value of 6, so it's a better chance of getting this than the Swarm. And remember, the Swarm was casting value of 7 and they had 2 buffs. It was either it buffs your saves or it buffs your movement. This one is casting value of 6 and it's wholly within 6 inches of the caster, so it's a bit closer to home. But it's got I feel I feel you probably use this one more than the Swarm. So, Uprooted Spirit. When this model is set up, the player who set it up can immediately make a move with it. So, as we know, it moves up to 8 inches, can fly. Terrors Unearthed. If the unit fails a battle shock within 3 inches of this model with this ability, add D3 to the number of models that flee. This ability has no effect on Sylvaneth units with the Sylvaneth keyword. I should hope not means that it's a spell for Sylvaneth. So, it's a nice little buff. If this thing's going on in battle, you've won the battle, you get extra guys running away. It's never a dull moment when you were going to get the upper hand like that. So, I like it. You know, I like it. But then, I like things that help you in battle. Right, next one is Strangle Root. After this model has moved, each unit that the model has passed across suffers D3 mortal wounds or D6 mortal wounds if that unit is wholly within 3 inches of an awakened Wyldwood. This ability has no effect on Sylvaneth heroes. So, we're going to go over the Wyldwoods later, but if you've got a caster protected in your Wyldwood, you've got this Vengeful Skull Root and you've got the Throne of Thorns, you've got very good magic protection for, you know, being a caster, and on top of that, you know, the rolls do get easier. So yeah, like I said, I think magic wise this is going to be dominant for the magic phase for a while. It's blowing everything else out the water. I think the only thing that's going to topple this is when they release, you know, the Teclis and Tyrion armies. So yeah, that's not even, you know, that's two really good war scrolls. These are not even like really bad ones, and then you get a really good one. They're all really good. So let's go on to the last one before we go on to the Wyldwoods. And last but not least, guys, we got my favourite looking model for the Sylvaneth thing. This is even better than the tree, and I think it's got the better rule. I think this is probably gonna appear on the table. If I'm wrong, please let me know. That's what the comment section is there for. But I do like how this affects the table. So, Glade Worm. Spell can move 8 inches and can fly. Yeah, basically, it's more tunneling, but the fly rules is because the terrain doesn't affect it. It's cast a value of 7, and if you successfully cast it, it turns up within 6 inches of your caster. The abilities are Burrowing Doom. When this model is set up, the player who set it up can immediately make a move. Death from the below. After this model has moved, roll a dice for each unit within 1 inch of it. On a 3+, so that's not a hard roll. On a 3+, that unit suffers D3 mortal wounds. This ability has no effect on Sylvaneth models. So 3+. Well, I'm sorry, you're gonna be getting this 9 times out of 10. A 3+, yeah, it's, people are gonna say it's a 50-50 chance and, you know, math harming it, but no offense, 3 plus is not a hard roll. So you're taking between 1 and 3 models away from our unit, on top of, say, being in the fight, getting buffed, and if you're lucky enough that you've, you know, got enough points in your army that you've taken the Glade Worm and another caster has taken the Skull Root, so that will knock them away as well. So the combinations on this thing is amazing, but heal and miss. After this model has moved, roll a dice for each Sylvaneth unit wholly within 6 inches of the model. On a 3 plus, you heal D3 wounds. So you can run him right through the meeting between the two battle lines just before they hit. It's in the herd, you're buffing your unit. This guy is mental. All the magic, the endless spells so far have been mental, and the fact that people are saying that they've got ways of making spell rolls easier when, like, you know, they can, you know, instead of a casting value of 7, you can get it down to 5. You can build up your Wyldwood. You can, you know, and the Wyldwoods have got an amazing effect with, like, you know, it's hard to be around them. This thing is just synergetic when it comes to what it can do, how everything buffs the army, negates the other one, and it's so simple to do. As you can see so far, it's just streamlined to what they were in the last edition, but this is fantastic. And I don't know what to say. I like the Glade Worm and the Skull Root. Tell me what your favourites are, because they might be different to mine, and they might be for different reasons, and I would like to know them. And yeah, that's the Wolf Scrolls. It's time to get into the Wyldwoods itself, so let's have a look at it. Right then, guys, we're going into the Wyldwood. So I'm going to leave the picture a little bit bigger, so hopefully it's easier for you guys to see. But yeah, here's the new and improved Wyldwood. It's not just your tree bases like it was last time. It is actual models for these now. So it looks like you've got a tree, you've got two pieces coming off there, so you can connect them up, as it's going to explain in the description. A Wyldwood is a single frame feature consisting of 3 to 6 wood models. Each tip of the Citadel wood model must touch the tip of a different Citadel wood model, with the tips of all models pointing inwards so that they can form a ring. The battlefield inside the ring is treated as being part of the Awakened Wyldwood. So it makes it easier to get your models in and out. You can always take them apart if it's a bit awkward, but basically you've got to connect the 3 models to make a Wyldwood. It says you can go up to 6, so I don't know how hard that is if you expand it into a 6, but by the look of it, it's a hefty size area that these things are covering, and if you put 6 together, you're taking up a lot of the board. But right, let's go into the abilities before, you know, I start ranting. Right, Overgrown Wilderness. Models that are not visible to each other, if you draw an imaginary line between 1 millimeter wide, drawn between the closest points of the two models, crosses over more than 1 inch of an Awakened Wyldwood. Scenery rule does not apply if the model can fly. So you've got cover, which is always good. So it's treated as being quite dense. You're not going to be able to see who is in there. So if you've got somebody in there, they're being protected. So that's exactly what you want your Wyldwood. Next one. At the end of the charge phase, roll a dice for each unit 1 inch of an Awakened Wyldwood, which does not have the Sylvaneth keyword. On a 6, that unit suffers D3 mortal wounds. So I'm going to leave that there, because that's part of the rant. It's good for a train feature, which is, you know, which you've got, if you've got like objectives close by, you know, in your setup, you can set it up, and you know, it's all, yeah, you're not gonna get it on a, you're not gonna get a six every time, but when you get that six, it could be clutch, because then that's one or two models that may not survive, and then it thins out the herd, ready for you to get your guys in. But neither here nor there. Right, Rouse by Magic. In the hero phase, if a spell successfully cast by a wizard held within 6 inches of an awakened wildwood is not unbound, roll a dice for each unit within 1 inch of the awakened wildwood that does not have the Sylvaneth keyword. On a 5+, that unit suffers D3 mortal wounds after that spell's effects have been resolved. So, if you're standing close by, you could lose mortal wounds. If you cast magic by him, you could lose mortal wounds. And you can expand these things up to like 6 models, taking up a chunk of your terrain. And this is where I think, yeah, it's great. That's, if that was on its own, and it was just the 3 woods, and that's it, I would say, do you know what? I'm happy with it. It's a forest there. And you know, Sylvaneth being one with nature can harness the power of realm roots. But it's the fact that when you listen to the GW community information and everything, you know that these spells, so you can plant more wildwoods, so you can have multiple of these around the place. And if you've got multiple, and you've got you've got that one model teleporting round from one tree to another, you've cut off the train. Your army can move anywhere on the battlefield. Anybody that takes the initiative and comes at your army is just losing models for being there. It seems a little bit overpowered for train. It seems a little bit, I don't know, it seems a bit much, even if they just turned around and GW said, oh, you can only have 2, and they're 3, and they're only 3, I would have gone, right, that's fine, because then you've got to strategize about where you're going to drop the next one. But this seems like it's, I'm not suggesting that there's some in your areas, but there's always going to be a person that's going to take full advantage of that, knowing that they are gaining extra, extra attacks with just having woods on the table. They're cutting off your terrain. They know that they're going to just run around, stop you being able to get to objectives, because they're going to plant the wildwoods. They're going to cast together. It's a little bit much. I know I've said that they're going to be incredible in the magic phase, but I feel the wildwoods is where everything can be abused. And it's such a big buff to some of the units. Like we said, seeing with the realm route, if it's within a certain distance of that, you know, it gets stronger. So you know, I'm not suggesting, you know, people who are assholes, because why wouldn't you, really, if, you know, your army's going to get buffed up by dropping more, why wouldn't you, because really you're handicapping yourself. But I think this would take the fun out of a game, knowing that you're being sectioned off, basically, from part of the game because of it. So yeah, I can see both sides of the argument, but I'm on the thing of it's a little bit too much, especially when you've got armies that have got you've got a you know, sacrifice a wound to them to get a buff. You've got just people who've got effects to like battle shock or a negative effect to like a spell. Everything seems moderate, except when it comes to the Wyldwoods, it seems a bit over the top. So that's my concern, is the fact that GW have gone, we're going to kind of go all in on Sylvaneth, but they've taken the fun out of it for the opponent. So I don't know. The only thing I can say, guys, is I am uneducated on Sylvaneth. I'm just looking at it from outside. It's not anybody in my club that plays Sylvaneth, so I can't play against it regular. So like I said, I'm looking out on the outside end. So if you were a Sylvaneth player, or you play Sylvaneth against them a lot, let me know what you guys think of the Wyldwood things. Do you, am I being a little bit melodramatic saying that this is going to take the fun out of the game, you know, or do you agree? Share down below, and then, you know, we can all have a chat about it. And that's it, guys, end of the video. I hope you all stuck with me during this War Scroll look, and mourn, I should say, at the end, wasn't it? It wasn't so much a rant, it wasn't so much an opinion, it was just mourning about Wyldwoods. And I shouldn't mourn, because this is a game that we all love. It's all the different aspects of the game that we like. So, you know, I realise now, after doing it, I might be putting off people, but it was a raw opinion. Say, it wasn't so much I sat back and, you know, checked what I was saying. It was a very raw opinion on what's happening. Now that I've taken two steps back, had a cup of tea, I can see the error in my way, so I want to apologise for that already. So, what do I say? Again, thank you for watching the video, guys. If you did enjoy it, please leave a like, comment, subscribe. If you're not already a subscriber, please share, because, like I said at the beginning, it helps us be seen. There's a Teespring account, we have a PayPal link down below, and follow us on Instagram and Twitter. There's going to be Blood Bowl updates soon, and I will be delving into Warcry in the next 2 weeks, so there's going to be a lot more content coming up. So, from me to you, thank you very much for watching the video. I'll see you next time.